Hello, hello, and welcome to the sleepy stream. Toning down the voice because I realized this is a sleepy stream. I hope you are all having a lovely evening tonight. We're getting close to Halloween, if you'll realize. It's right around the bend, so perhaps in the near future you can expect some spooky stories for that. Perhaps. I'm not saying it's definitely going to happen, but I think I have a couple of scary stories on my mind. So, I hope everyone's been having a wonderful evening. I am looking forward to this chapter we're doing tonight because it is the journey from platform 9 3/4. It's the train ride to Hogwarts, which is an amazing part of the movies and the books. I obviously haven't reread these in a while, so I'm looking quite forward to getting into them. Anyways, music's probably also really loud, I'm realizing. So, as per usual, the norm of the sleepy stream, we're gonna stall for a little bit, wait for people to float in, if they may do or not. So to pass the time, I'll play you in rock, paper, scissors, okay? So, we're gonna go rock, paper, scissors, shoot, okay? Rock, paper, scissors, shoot, got it? Okay, and then I'll throw something, and I'll just keep throwing stuff until someone comes into chat and throws something down with me. That only seems fair. So, you ready? Okay. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Ooh, no, I'm too good for you. I always know you throw paper first. There's no way you're gonna get it. Okay, you ready? Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Oh. Oh, almost got me there. I knew you were gonna go paper again because I said it out loud. You thought that might throw me off. No, okay. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Aw, oh, damn. I didn't think you'd pull paper out a third time in a row. You're so good at this. You're really... You should be the world champion, honestly. Okay. Still stalling it out, because 139, I think, is our principal. Anyways, in terms of getting cozy for this evening, as you can see, I'm in a comfortable turtleneck, and of course, swathed in my blanket. Joining me, as always, is Popper. I'm very cozied out here. I feel the lighting is great. We don't have the moon tonight, for it has been taken to the common room, but it's out there somewhere, floating around. I've got, of course, a lovely glass of tea tonight. It's Earl Grey with a lot of milk. Like, this is one-third milk, which is absurd. So, Earl Grey tea with some milk and a bit of sugar. And some hobnob to wash that all down. Or, I guess, vice versa. So. Yeah, so I am all set in terms of coziness. I've even got some treats for today, because if you'll remember, spoilers, in this chapter on the train, there's the trolley, and I've got some Birdie Bots Every Flavor Beans, which is, this thing is actually full of money, and I've got a chocolate frog, it's a famous Witches and Wizards card. I wonder who it is. I bet it's someone cool. No, it's Helga Hufflepuff. That's right, you thought we're gonna get a cool card out of this? No way, dude. Helga Hufflepuff. I'll let you in on a secret. When I went out to the Harry Potter studio tour, I got two of these, and I opened both of them, and they were both Helga Hufflepuff. And one of them was supposed to be for a friend. And I was like, damn it, like, if one of them had a cooler card, I could take that and give them the Helga Hufflepuff one, but no, it was two Helga Hufflepuff cards. Anyways. I will take a small bite out of this chocolate frog. I mean, honestly, I think this is about $12 of chocolate or something. And it's worth it, because when you think about it, it's solid milk chocolate. But also, you're paying about 12 bucks for a large chocolate frog and a card of Helga Hufflepuff. So is it really worth it? That is, yeah, we are really washing down this tea with things that are not washdownable. Okay, you know what? I think we'll give it just a bit longer and get started, because the journey from platform 9 3/4 is ready to begin. Sounds like someone's knocking at my door. Yeah. I'm going to go get that, so be patient. Okay, there were in fact some people who needed to be let into my room and, or the suite, I guess, and they have now been let in. So, we're back on track for some Harry Potter, I think. I'm going to have one last hobnob and some more tea just to get all nice and ready for the stream, and then I think we're gonna get into this chapter. I do really wonder why they're called hobnobs. No one's ever told me the answer to that. I know it's a quick Google search away, but I feel like it wouldn't be as fun as like someone telling me like the origin story. This is a rough beginning to this stream. Me eating biscuits, crunching loudly into a microphone. Ooh. Wouldn't dream of it. Okay. I think it's best if we get started for tonight. People will roll in as they do. But in the meantime, we've got Harry Potter to read. So tonight we will be reading Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, Chapter 6, The Journey from Platform 9 3/4. Harry's last month with the Dursleys wasn't fun. True, Dudley was now so scared of Harry he wouldn't stay in the same room, while Aunt Petunia and Uncle Vernon didn't shut Harry in his cupboard, force him to do anything, or shout at him. In fact, they didn't speak to him at all. Half terrified, half furious, they acted as though any chair with Harry in it was empty. Although this was a bit of an improvement in many ways, it did become a bit depressing after a while. Harry kept to his room, with New Owl for company. He had decided to call her Hedwig, a name he had found in A History of Magic. School books were very interesting. He lay on his bed reading late into the night. Hedwig was swooping in and out of the open window as she pleased. It was lucky that Aunt Petunia didn't come in to Hoover anymore, because Hedwig kept deciding to bring back dead mice. Every night, before he went to sleep, Harry ticked off another day on the piece of paper that he had pinned to the wall, counting down to September the 1st. On the last day of August, he thought he'd better speak to his aunt and uncle about getting to King's Cross Station next day, so he went down to the living room where they were watching a quiz show on television. He cleared his throat to let him know he was there, and Dudley screamed and ran from the room.
Uncle Vernon?
Uncle Vernon grunted to show he was listening.
I need to be at King's Cross tomorrow to go to Hogwarts.
Uncle Vernon grunted again.
Would it be alright if you gave me a lift?
Grunt. Harry supposed that meant yes.
Thank you.
He was about to go back upstairs when Uncle Vernon actually spoke. Funny way of getting into a wizard school. That was my Hagrid voice, sorry.
Funny way of getting into a wizard school. The train. Magic carpets all got punctures, have they?
Harry didn't say anything to this.
Where's the school, anyways?
I don't know,
said Harry, realizing this for the first time. He pulled the ticket Hagrid had given him out of his pocket.
I just take the train from Platform 9 3/4 at 11 o'clock, he read.
His aunt and uncle had stared.
Platform what?
9 3/4.
Don't talk rubbish, said Uncle Vernon. There is no Platform 9 3/4.
It's on my ticket.
Barking, said Uncle Vernon. Howling mad, the lot of them. You'll see. You just wait. All right, we'll take you to King's Cross. We're going up to London tomorrow anyways, or I wouldn't bother.
Why are you going to London?
Harry asked, trying to keep things friendly.
Taking Dudley to the hospital, growled Uncle Vernon. Gotta have that ruddy tail removed before he goes to Smeltings.
Harry woke up at 5 o'clock the next morning and was too excited and nervous to go back to sleep. He got up and pulled on his jeans because he didn't want to walk into the station in his wizard's robes. He'd changed on the train. He checked his Hogwarts list yet again to make sure he had everything he needed, saw that Hedwig was shut safely in her cage,
and then paced the room, waiting for the Dursleys to get up. 2 hours later, Harry's huge, heavy trunk had been loaded into the Dursleys' car. Aunt Petunia had talked Dudley into sitting next to Harry, and they had set off. They reached King's Cross at 10:30. Uncle Vernon dumped Harry's trunk onto a trolley and wheeled it into the station for him. Harry thought this was strangely kind until Uncle Vernon stopped dead, facing the platforms with a nasty grin on his face.
"Well, there you are, boy. Platform 9, platform 10. Your platform should be somewhere in the middle, but they don't seem to have built it yet, do they?"
He was quite right, of course. There was a big plastic number 9 over one platform, and a big plastic number 10 over another one next to it. And in the middle, nothing at all.
"Have a good term," said Uncle Vernon, with an even nastier smile.
He left without another word. Harry then turned and saw the Dursleys drive away. All three of them were laughing. Harry's mouth went rather dry. What on earth was he going to do? He was starting to attract a lot of funny looks because of Hedwig. He'd have to ask someone. He stopped a passing guard, but didn't dare mention Platform 9 and 3 quarters. The guard had never heard of Hogwarts, and when Harry couldn't even tell him what part of the country it was in, he started to get annoyed. As though Harry was being stupid on purpose. Getting desperate, Harry asked for the train that left at 11 o'clock, but the guard said there wasn't one. In the end, the guard strode away, muttering about time wasters. Harry was now trying hard not to panic. According to the large clock over the arrivals board, he had 10 minutes left to get on the train to Hogwarts, and he had no idea how to do it. He was stranded in the middle of a station with a trunk he could hardly lift, a pocket full of wizard money, and a large owl. Hagrid must have forgotten to tell him something you had to do, like tapping on the third brick on the left to get into Diagon Alley. He wondered if he should get out his wand and start tapping the ticket box between the platforms 9 and 10.
At that moment, a group of people passed just behind him, and he caught a few words of what they were saying. Packed with muggles, of course.
Harry swung around. The speaker was a plump woman, talking to 4 boys all with flaming red hair. Each one of them was pushing a trunk like Harry's in the front of him.
And they had owls.
Or an owl, that is to say.
Heart hammering, Harry pushed his trolley after them. They stopped, and so did he, just near enough to hear what they were saying.
"Now,
what's the platform number?"
said the boy's mother.
9 3/4,
piped a small girl, also redheaded, who was holding her hand.
"Mom, can I go?"
"You're not old enough, Ginny.
Now be quiet." "All right, Percy, you go first." What looked like the oldest boy marched towards platform 9 and 10. Harry watched, careful not to blink in case he missed it. But just as the redhead boy reached the divide between the two platforms, a large crowd of tourists came swarming in front of him. And by the time the last rucksack had cleared away, the boy had vanished.
"Fred, you next,"
the plump woman said.
"I'm not Fred, I'm George," said the boy. "Honestly, woman, call yourself our mother. Can't you tell I'm George?"
"Sorry, George, dear."
"I'm only joking, I am Fred,"
said the boy, and he went off. His twin called after him to hurry up, and he must have done, because a second later, he had gone.
But how had he done it?
Now the third brother was walking briskly towards the ticket barrier. He was almost there, and then quite suddenly, he wasn't anywhere. There was nothing else for it.
"Excuse me,"
Harry said to the plump woman.
"Hello, dear. First time at Hogwarts. Ron's new, too."
She pointed at the last and youngest of her sons. He was tall, thin, and gangly, with freckles, big hands, and feet, and a long... with big hands and feet, and a long nose, that is to say.
"Yes," said Harry. The thing is, I don't know how."
"How to get on the platform," she said kindly. Harry nodded. "Not to worry," she said. "All you have to do is walk straight at the barrier between platforms 9 and 10. Don't stop and don't be scared, you'll crash into it. That's very important. Best do it with a bit of a run if you're nervous.
Go now, before Ron."
"Okay, said Harry. He pushed his trolley around and stared at the barrier. It looked very solid. He started to walk towards it. People jostled him on their ways to platforms 9 and 10. Harry walked more quickly. He was going to smash right into that ticket box, and then he'd be in trouble. Leaning forward on his trolley, he broke into a heavy run. The barrier was coming nearer and nearer.
Oh, hello, Taylor. Hello, Adria. We're just doing platform 9 3/4. Just about to go through the transition. Anyways.
The barrier was coming nearer and nearer. He wouldn't be able to stop. The trolley was out of control. He was a foot away. He closed his eyes, ready for the crash. It didn't come. He kept on running.
He opened his eyes.
A scarlet steam engine was waiting to a platform packed with people. A sign overhead said, Hogwarts Express, 11 o'clock. Harry looked behind him and saw a wrought iron archway where the ticket box had been. The words, Platforms 9 3/4, had been written on it. He had done it.
Smoke from the engine drifted over the heads of the chattering crowd, while cats of every color wound here and there between their legs. Owls hooted to each other in a disgruntled sort of way over the babble and the scraping of heavy trunks. The first few carriages were already packed with students, some hanging out of the window to talk to their families, some fighting over seats. Harry pushed his trolley off down the platform in search of an empty seat. He passed a round-faced boy who was saying,
Cretton, I've lost my toad again.
Oh, Neville, he heard the old woman's eye. A boy with dreadlocks was surrounded by a small crowd.
Give us a look, Lee. Come on.
The boy lifted the lid of the box in his arms, and people around him shrieked and yelled as something inside poked a long, hairy leg out. Harry pressed on through the crowd until he found an empty compartment near the end of the train. He put Hedwig inside first, and then started to shove and heave his trunk towards the train door. He lifted it up the steps, but could hardly raise the other end. Twice, he dropped it painfully on his foot.
What hand?
No, want a hand. Sorry, yikes.
Want a hand?
It was one of the red-haired twins he had followed through the ticket box.
Yes, please, Harry panted.
Oi, Fred! Come here and help! With the twins' help, Harry's trunk was at last tucked away in a corner of the compartment.
Thanks,
said Harry, pushing his sweaty hair out of his eyes.
What's that?
Said one of the twins suddenly, pointing at Harry's lightning scar.
Blimey,
said the other twin.
Are you?
He is, said the first one.
Aren't you?
He added to Harry.
What?
Said Harry.
Harry Potter,
chorused the twins.
Oh, him, said Harry. I mean, yes.
Yes, I am. The two boys gawped at him, and Harry felt himself going red. Then, to his relief, a voice came floating in through the train's open door.
Fred, George, are you in there?
Coming, Mother.
With one last look at Harry, the twins hopped off the train. Harry sat down next to the window where, half hidden, he could watch the red-haired family on the platform and hear what they were saying. The mother had just taken out a handkerchief.
Ron, you've got something on your nose.
The youngest boy tried to jerk out of the way, but she grabbed him and began rubbing the end of his nose.
Mom, get off! He wiggled.
Ugh, has it got Ronnie got something on his nosey? Said one of the twins.
Shut up, said Ron. Where's Percy?
Said their mother.
He's coming now.
The oldest boy came striding into sight. He had already changed into his billowing black Hogwarts robes, and Harry noticed a shiny red and gold badge on his chest with the letter P on it.
Can't stay long, Mother, he said. I'm up front. The prefects have got two compartments to themselves.
Oh, you are a prefect, Percy, said one of the twins with the air of great surprise.
You should have said something. We had no idea.
Hang on, I think I remember saying something about it, said the other twin.
Once,
or twice,
or a minute,
all summer. Oh, is the stream down or can you guys still see me? Because the stream totally just kicked out on my laptop. I'm going to refresh that. I think it's still working. Okay, yeah, we are still up and running. Great. Awesome. Where am I?
Oh, shut up, said Percy the prefect.
How come Percy gets new robes anyways?
Said one of the twins.
Because he's a prefect, said their mother fondly.
All right, dear. Well, have a good term. Send me an owl when you get there.
She kissed Percy on the cheek, and then he left. Then she turned to the twins.
Now, you do. This year, you behave yourselves. If I got one more owl telling me how you've blown up a toilet, or...
Blown up a toilet? We've never blown up a toilet. Great idea, though. Thanks, Mom. It's not funny. And look after Ron.
Don't worry, Icky Ronalkins is safe with us.
Shut up,
said Ron again. He was almost as tall as the twins already, and his nose was still pink where his mother had rubbed it.
Guess what, Mom? Guess what? Guess who we met on the train?
Harry went back quickly so they could see him looking.
You know that black-haired boy who was near us at the station? Know who he is?
Who?
Harry Potter!
He heard the little girl's voice.
Oh, Mom. Mom, can I go on the train and see him? Mom, oh please!
You've already seen him, Ginny. And the poor boy isn't something you goggle at in a zoo.
Is he really, Fred? How do you know?
Asked him. Saw his lightning scar. It's really like lightning.
Poor dear, no wonder he was all alone. I wondered. He was ever so polite when he asked how to get to the platform. Never mind that. Do you think he remembers what you know who looks like?
Their mother suddenly became very stern.
I forbid you to ask him, Fred. No, don't you dare. As though he needs reminding of that on his first day at school. All right, keep your hair on.
A whistle sounded.
Hurry up,
their mother said, and the three boys clambered onto the train. They leaned out of their windows for a kiss, for her to kiss them goodbye, and her younger sister began to cry.
Don't, Ginny. We'll send you loads of owls, and we'll send you a Hogwarts toilet seat.
George!
Only joking, Mom.
The train began to move. Harry saw the boys' mothers waving and their sister half lying, half crying, laughing and running to keep up with the train, until it gathered too much speed and then she fell back and waved. Harry watched the girl and her mother disappear as the train rounded the corner. And here, actually I think this is, or let me double check, this is I think our first illustration of the chapter. It is, we've got a lovely double page illustration of the Hogwarts Express. Harry down on the platform, and several owls flying about. That is a gorgeous illustration right there. Love it. Anyways, houses flashed past the window. Harry felt a great leap of excitement. He didn't know where he was going, but he had a better... He didn't know where he was going to, but it had to be better than what he was leaving behind. The door of the compartment slid open, and the youngest red-haired boy came in.
"Anyone sitting there?" he asked, pointing to the seat opposite of Harry. "Everywhere else is full."
Harry shook his head, and the boy sat down. He glanced at Harry, and then looked quickly out of the window, pretending he hadn't looked. Harry saw he still had a black mark on his nose.
"Hey, Ron."
The twins were back.
"Listen, we're going down to the middle of the train. Lee Jordan's got a giant tarantula down there."
Right, mumbled Ron.
Harry, did we introduce ourselves?
Fred and George Weasley, and this is Ron, our brother.
See you later, then.
Bye, said Harry and Ron. The twins slid the compartment door shut behind them.
Are you really Harry Potter?
Ron blurted out.
Harry nodded. Oh, well, I thought it might have been one of Fred and George's jokes, said Ron. And have you really got, you know?
He pointed at Harry's forehead. Harry pulled back his fringe to show the lightning scar. Ron stared.
So that's where you know who?
Yes, said Harry, but I can't remember it.
Nothing,
said Ron eagerly.
Well, I remember quite a lot of green light, but nothing else.
Wow, said Ron. He sat and stared at Harry for a few moments. Then, as though he suddenly realized what he was doing, he quickly looked out of the window again.
Are all your families wizards?
He asked Harry, who found Ron just as interesting as Ron found him.
Yes, I think so, said Ron. I think Mom's got a second cousin who's an accountant, but we never talked to him.
So you must know loads of magic already. The Weasleys were clearly one of those old wizarding families the Pale Boy and Diagon Alley had talked about.
I heard that you went to live with Muggles, said Ron. What are they like? Horrible.
Well, not all of them. My aunt and uncle and cousin are, though. I wish I had three... I just had, like, a mild stroke. I wish I had three wizard brothers.
Five, said Ron. For some reason, he was looking gloomy. I'm the sixth in our family to go to Hogwarts. You could say I've got a lot to live up to. Bill and Charlie have already left. Bill was head boy, and Charlie was captain of the Quidditch team.
Now, Percy's a prefect, Fred and George mess around a lot, but they still get really good marks, and everyone thinks they're really funny. Everyone expects me to do as well as the others, but if I do, it's no big deal, because they did it first. You never get anything new either with five brothers. I got Percy's old Bill's old robes, Charlie's old wand, and Percy's old rat. Ron reached inside his jacket and pulled out a fat gray rat, which was asleep. His name's Scabbers, but he's useless. He hardly wakes up. Percy's got an owl from my dad for being made prefect, but they couldn't afford. I got Scabbers instead. Ron's ears went pink. He seemed to think he had said too much because he went back to staring out of the window. Harry didn't think there was anything wrong with not being able to afford an owl. In fact, he'd never had money in his life until a month ago, and he told Ron so, all about having to wear Dudley's old clothes and never getting proper birthday presents. This seemed to cheer Ron up. And until Hagrid told me, I didn't know anything about being a wizard, or my parents, or Voldemort. Ron gasped. What? Said Harry. You said you know whose name, said Ron, sounding both shocked and impressed. I'd have thought you, of all people. I'm not trying to be brave or anything, saying the name, said Harry. I just never knew you shouldn't. See what I mean? I've got loads to learn, I bet, he added, voicing for the first time something that had been worrying him a lot lately. Bet I'm the worst in the class. You won't be. There's loads of people who came from Muggle families, and they weren't quick enough. While they had been talking, the train carried them out of London. Now they were speeding past fields of cows and sheep. They were quiet for a time, watching the fields and lanes fly past. Around 12:30, there was a great clattering outside in the corridor, and a small, smiling, dimpled woman slid back their doors and said, "Anything off the trolley, dears?" Harry, who hadn't had any breakfast, leapt to his feet, but Ron's ears went pink again, and he muttered he had brought sandwiches. Harry went out into the corridor. He had never had any money for sweets with the Dursleys, and now he had pockets rattling with gold and silver. He was ready to buy as many Mars bars as he could carry. But the woman didn't have Mars bars. What she did have were birdie butts, every flavor beans. Definitely not filled with a bunch of cash. Drubal's best blowing gum. Chocolate frogs, which are already half eaten and only contain Helga Hufflepuff. Pumpkin pasties, cauldron cakes, and licorice ones, and a number of other strange things Harry had never seen in his life. Not wanting to miss anything, he got some of everything and paid the woman 11 silver sickles and 7 bronze nuts. Ron stared as Harry brought all of it back into the compartment and tipped it onto an empty seat. Hungry, are you? Starving, Harry said, taking a large bite out of a pumpkin pasty. Pasty? Yes. Ron had taken out a lumpy package and unwrapped it. There were 4 sandwiches in there. He pulled one of them apart and said, She always forgets I don't like corned beef. Swap you for one of these, said Harry, holding up a pasty. Pasty? God. Go on. You don't want this, it's all dry, said Ron. She hasn't got much time, he added quickly, you know, with the 5 of us. Go on, have a pasty, said Harry, who had never had anything to share before, or, indeed, anyone to share it with. Do a mukbang. Yes, I should. That is honestly the dream job. Can you imagine getting paid to eat food? That's, like, amazing. Okay, anyways. Sorry, brief intermission to vouch for how awesome mukbangs are. I would love to do one. Please pay me money so I can eat food for you. Thank you very much. Don't forget to like, favorite, and subscribe. It was a nice feeling, sitting there with Ron, eating their way through all of Harry's pasties and cake. The sandwiches lay forgotten. What are these? Harry asked Ron, holding up... a pack of chocolate frogs! They're not really frogs, are they? He was starting to feel that nothing would surprise him. No, said Ron. But... what the card is. But see what the card is. I'm missing a Gryffindor. What? Oh, of course, you wouldn't know. Chocolate frogs have cards inside of them. You know, to collect famous witches and wizards. I've got about 500, but I haven't got an Agrippa or a Ptolemy. Harry unwrapped his chocolate frog and picked up the card. It showed a man's face. He was wearing
half-moon glasses, had a long, crooked nose, and flowing silver hair, beard, and mustache. Under the picture was the name Albus Dumbledore. There is Albus Dumbledore. I need to reposition that light so it's not as obnoxious when you're trying to look at the images.
So this is Dumbledore, said Harry. Don't tell me you've ever heard of Dumbledore, said Ron.
Can I have a frog? I might get a grippa.
Thanks.
Harry turned over his card and read. Albus Dumbledore, currently headmaster of Hogwarts, considered by many the greatest wizard of modern times. Professor Dumbledore is particularly famous for his defeat of the dark wizard Grindelwald in 1945, for the discovery of the 12 uses of dragon's blood, and his work in alchemy with his partner Nicholas Flamel. Professor Dumbledore enjoys chamber music and 10-pin bowling. Harry turned the card back over and saw, to his astonishment, that Dumbledore's face had disappeared.
He's gone!
Well, you can't expect him to hang around all day, said Ron. He'll be back. No, I've got Morgana again, and I've got about 6 of her.
You want it? You can start collecting.
Ron's eyes strayed onto the pile of chocolate frogs, waiting to be unwrapped.
Help yourself, said Harry. But in, you know, the Muggle world, people just stay put in photos. Do they? They don't move at all.
Ron sounded amazed. Weird. Harry stared as Dumbledore slided back into the picture on his card, gave him a small smile. Ron was more interested in eating the frogs than looking at the famous witches and wizards card, but Harry couldn't keep his eyes off of them. Soon enough, he had not only Dumbledore and Morgana, but Hengist of Woodcroft, Albrecht Grunion, Cersei, Parcellius, and Merlin. He finally tore his eyes away from the druidess Cleodna, who was scratching her nose, to open a bag of Bertie Bott's every flavor beans.
You want to be careful with those, Ron warned Harry. When they say every flavor, they mean every flavor. You know, you got all the ordinary ones like chocolate and peppermint and marmalade, but then you get spinach and liver and tripe.
George reckons he had a bogey-flavored one once. Ron picked up a green bean and looked at it carefully and bit into a corner.
Ugh, see? Sprouts.
They had a good time eating the every-flavored beans. Harry got toast, coconut, baked bean, strawberry, curry, grass, coffee, sardine, and was even brave enough to nibble the end of a funny gray one which Ron wouldn't touch, which turned out to be pepper. The countryside now flying past the window became wilder. The neat fields had gone, now there were woods, twisting rivers, and dark green hills. There was a knock on the door of their compartment, and the round-faced boy Harry had passed on the platform 9 3/4 came in. He looked tearful.
Sorry, he said, but have any of you seen Toad at all?
Ooh, that's like a Samwise Gamgee accent right there. They shook his head and he wailed.
I've lost him. He keeps getting away from me.
He'll turn up, said Harry.
Yes, said the boy miserably. Well, if you see him at all.
He left.
Don't know why he's so bothered, said Ron. If I bought a toad, I'd lose it as quick as I could. Mind you, I brought Scabbers, so I can't talk.
The rat was still snoozing on Ron's lap.
Sorry, I don't know why I default to the Minnesota sorry, because I don't know why it was like this past year I started saying sorry instead of sorry, and now I'm running away with it. Sorry!
Anyways, the rat was still snoozing on Ron's lap.
He might have died and you wouldn't know the difference, Ron said in disgust.
I tried to turn him yellow yesterday to make him more interesting, but the spell didn't work.
Look, I'll show you.
He rummaged around in his trunk and pulled out a very battered-looking wand. It was chipped in places, and something white was glinting at the end.
Unicorn hair is nearly poking out. Anyways, he raised his wand when the compartment door slid open.
The toadless boy was back, but this time, he had a girl with him. She was already wearing her new Hogwarts robes.
Has anyone seen a toad? Neville's lost one, she said.
She had a bossy sort of voice. Lots of bushy brown hair and rather large front teeth.
We already told him we haven't seen it,
said Ron, but the girl wasn't listening. She was looking at the wand in his hand.
Oh, are you going to do magic? Let's see if you can, then.
She sat down. Ron was taken aback.
Alright.
Sunshine's daisies, buttermellow, turn the stupid fat rat yellow! He waved the wand, but nothing happened. Scabrous stayed gray and fast asleep.
Are you sure that's a real spell? Said the girl.
Well, it's not a very good one, is it? I've tried a few simple spells just for practice, and it's always worked for me. Nobody in my family's magic at all. It was ever such a surprise when I got my letter, but I was so pleased, of course. I mean, it's the very best school of witchcraft there is. I've learned all of our sets of books off heart, of course. I just hope it'll be enough. I'm Hermione Granger, by the ways. Who are you?
She said this all very fast.
Ron looked at Harry and was relieved to see... Harry looked at Ron and was relieved to see by his stunned face that he hadn't learned all the set of books by heart either.
I'm Ron Weasley, he muttered.
Harry Potter, said Harry. Are you really? Said Hermione. I know all about you, of course. I've got a few extra books for background reading, and you're in Modern Magical History, and the Rise and Fall of the Dark Arts, and Great Wizarding Events of the 20th Century.
I am, said Harry, feeling dazed.
Goodness, didn't you know? I'd have found out everything if I could if it was me, said Hermione. Do either of you know what house you'll be in? I've been asking around, and I hope I'm in Gryffindor. It sounds by far the best. I hear Dumbledore was in it himself, but I suppose Ravenclaw wouldn't be too bad. Anyways, we'd better go and look for Neville's toad. You two had better change, you know. I expect we'll be getting there soon.
She left and was taking the toadless boy with her. Whatever house I'm in, I hope she's not in it, said Ron. He threw his wand back into his trunk.
Stupid spell. George gave it to me. I bet he knew it was a dud.
What house are your brothers in? Harry asked.
Gryffindor, said Ron. Gloom seemed to be settling in on him again.
Mum and Dad were in it too. I don't know what they'll say if I'm not. I suppose Ravenclaw would be too bad. But imagine if they put me in Slytherin.
That's the house you know who was in?
Yeah, said Ron. He flopped back into his seat, looking depressed.
You know, I think Scabbers whiskers are looking a bit lighter, said Harry, trying to take Ron's mind off houses.
So what do your oldest brothers do now that they've left anyways?
Harry was wondering what a wizard did once he finished school.
Charlie's in Romania studying dragons, and Bill's in Africa doing something for Gringotts.
Did you hear about Gringotts? It's been all over the Daily Prophet, but I suppose you don't get that with muggles.
Someone tried to rob a high security vault.
Harry stared.
Really? What happened to them?
Nothing. That's why it's such big news. They haven't been caught. My dad says it must have been a powerful dark wizard get around Gringotts, but they don't think they took anything. That's what's odd.
Of course, everyone gets scared when something like this happens, in case you know who's behind it. Harry turned this news over in his mind. He was starting to get a prickle of fear every time you know who was mentioned. He supposed this was all part of entering the magical world, but it'd have been a lot more comfortable saying Voldemort without worrying.
What's your Quidditch team? Asked Ron.
I don't know any, said Harry.
What?
Ron, looking dumbfounded.
Oh wait, it's the best game in the world!
And he was off, explaining all about the four balls and the positions of seven players, describing famous games he had been to with his brothers, and the broomstick he'd like to get if he had the money. He was just taking Harry through the finer points of the game when the compartment doors slid open yet again. But it wasn't Neville Toadless Boy, or Hermione Granger at all this time.
Is that you, Brandon? Hello, how's it going, Brandon? Things are going great. We're just reading Harry Potter. I think you're joining us just near the end of this. I'm not mistaken. We've just got a couple more pages before the next chapter. But we're going to continue. Persist on.
Three boys entered, and Harry recognized the one in the middle at once. It was the pale boy from Madame Malkin's rope shop. He was looking at Harry with a lot more interest than he had shown back in Diagon Alley.
Is it true, he said, they're all saying down the train that Harry Potter is in a compartment. So it's you, is it?
Yes, said Harry.
He was looking at the other boys. Both of them were thick-set and looked extremely mean, standing on either side. Am I congested? I am congested right now. I'm still sort of getting off a cold, yeah.
Sorry, I don't sound my best, that is true. Anyways. Standing either side on the pale boy, they looked like bodyguards. Oh, this is Crab and this is Goyle, said the pale boy carelessly, noticing where Harry was looking. And my name's Malfoy. Draco Malfoy. Ron gave a slight cough, which might have meant hiding a snigger. Draco Malfoy looked at him. Think my name's funny, do you? No need to ask who you are. My father told me all about the Weasleys and their red hair, freckles, and more children than they can afford. He turned back to Harry. You'll soon be finding out some wizard families are better than others, Potter. You don't want to go making friends with the wrong sort. I can help you there. He held out his hand to shake Harry's, but Harry didn't take it. I think I can see who the wrong sort are for myself, thanks, he said coolly. Draco Malfoy didn't go red, but a pink tinge appeared in his pale cheeks. I'd be careful if I were you, Potter, he said slowly. Unless you're a bit politer, you'll live the same way as your parents. They didn't know what was good for them either. You hang around with riff-raff like the Weasleys and Hagrid and they'll rub off on you. Both Ron and Harry stood up. Ron's face was as red as his hair. Say that again, he said. Oh, you're gonna fight us, are you? Malfoy sneered. Unless you get out now, said Harry, more bravely than he felt, because Crabbe and Goyle were a lot bigger than him or Ron. But we don't feel like leaving, do we, boys? We've eaten all our food, and you still seem to have some. Goyle reached out towards the chocolate frogs next to Ron. Ron leapt forward, but before he so much as touched Goyle, Goyle read out a horrible yell. Scabbers, the rat, was hanging off of his finger, sharp little teeth sunk deep into Goyle's knuckle. Crabbe and Malfoy backed away as Goyle swung Scabbers round and round, howling, and when Scabbers finally flew off and hit the window, all three of them disappeared at once. Perhaps they had thought there were more rats lurking amongst the sweets, or perhaps they had heard footsteps because a second later Hermione Granger had come in. What has been going on? She said, looking at all the sweets over the floor and Scabbers picking up Ron picking up Scabbers by the tail. I think he's been knocked out, said Ron to Harry. He looked closer at Scabbers. No, I don't believe it. He's gone back to sleep. And so he had. You've met Malfoy before? Harry explained about their meeting in Diagon Alley. I've heard of their family, said Ron darkly. They were some of the first to come back to our side after you-know-who disappeared. Said they'd been bewitched. My dad doesn't believe it. He says Malfoy's dad didn't need an excuse to go over to the dark side. He turned to Hermione. Can we help you with something? You better hurry up and put on your robes. I've just been up to the front to ask the driver, and he says we're nearly there. You haven't been fighting, have you? You'll be in trouble before we even get there. Scabbers has been fighting, he said. Not us, scowling at her. Would you mind leaving us while we change? Alright, I only came in here because people outside are behaving very childishly, running up and down the corridors, said Hermione in a sniffy voice. And you've got dirt on your nose, by the ways. Did you know? Ron glared at her as she left. Harry peered out of the window. It was getting dark. He could see mountains and forests under a deep purple sky. The train did seem to be slowing down. He and Ron took off their jackets and pulled on their long black robes. Ron's were a bit short for him. You could see his trainers underneath them. A voice echoed through the train. We will be reaching Hogwarts in 5 minutes' time. Please leave your luggage on the train and it will be taken to the school separately. Harry's stomach lurched with nerves and Ron, he saw, looked paler under his freckles. They crammed their pockets with the last of the sweets and joined the crowd thronging the corridors. The train slowed right down and finally stopped. People pushed their way towards the door and out onto a tiny dark platform. Harry shivered in the cold night air. A lamp came bobbing over the heads of the students, and Harry heard a familiar voice. First years over here. All right, Harry. Also here, bit of a spoiler, because it's not technically come yet in the book, but they positioned it here for one reason or another. There is Hogwarts Castle. I don't know why. There we go. Hogwarts Castle. First glimpse. Okay. But we are not there yet. Here we go. Hagrid's big, hairy face beamed over the sea of heads. Come on!
Follow me. Any more first years? Mind the step now. First years, follow me.
Slipping and stumbling, they followed Hagrid down what seemed to be a steep, narrow path. It was so dark either side of there, where Harry thought there must be thick trees there. Nobody spoke. Neville, the boy who kept losing his toad, sniffed once or twice.
You'll get your first sight of Hogwarts in a sea,
Hagrid called over his shoulder. Just round the bend, here. There was a loud, ooh. The narrow path had opened suddenly, and onto the edge of a great black lake. Perched atop a high mountain on the other side, its windows sparkling in the starry sky, was a vast castle with many turrets and towers. No more than four to a boat, Hagrid called, pointing to the fleet of little boats sitting in the water by the shore. Harry and Ron were followed into their boat by Neville and Hermione.
Everyone in, shouted Hagrid, who had a boat to himself. Right then, forward!
And the fleet of little boats moved off all at once, gliding across the lake, which was smooth as glass. Everyone was silent, staring up at the great castle overhead. It towered over them as they sailed nearer and nearer to the cliff on which it stood.
Heads down, yelled Hagrid as the first boats reached the cliff.
They all bent their heads, and the little boats carried them through a curtain of ivy which had hid a wide opening in the cliff. They were carried along a dark tunnel which seemed to be taking them right under the castle until they reached a kind of underground harbor where they clambered onto the rocks and pebbles.
Oi, you there! Is this your toad?
Said Hagrid, who was checking the boats and people climbed out of them.
Trevor!
Cried Neville blissfully, holding out his hands. Then they clambered up onto the passageway in the rock, after Hagrid's lamp, coming out at last onto smooth, damp grass, right in the shadow of the castle. They walked up a flight of stone steps, and everyone crowded around a huge oak front door.
Everyone's here! You there, still got your toad?
Hagrid raised a gigantic fist and knocked three times on the castle's door. And there you have Chapter 6 of Harry Potter and Philosopher's Stone. Another interesting chapter, very fun. The sweets, which I have here, I'm definitely gonna eat the rest of this chocolate frog for the evening. Okay, thank you so much for joining, Adria. Wonderful timing. Have fun going out or whatever. Catch you guys around. Anyways, to the rest of the stream. Thank you so much for popping by for Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, Chapter 6. It was lovely having you here. I really hope you enjoyed it. And stay cozy out there, friends.